I would like to give a few introductory remarks about this book panel and about the book that I wrote in the European Research Council, which it has been published beginning of 2017 with Politikers. So the first part is what is the book about? I will just very briefly summarize this and discuss a little bit also the dynamic of this EU policy field of innovation policy that emerged in the emerged in the 1990s. And then I want also to stress a little bit what is the significance of the book, mainly what it meant to write it from a distinctive perspective. The book is about the history of the European Research Council, deals from the period from 2000 to 2013, and with something that is very often called by scientists and by political actors a success story. It is structured along three sections, basically the prehistory of the ERC from 2000 to 2007, then the governance issues that arose once the ERC was established from 2007 to 2013, and then also a separate level, the operational issues of the ERC. Just very briefly for each of these three sections, in the prehistory section, I deal with the problem how to turn an idea, a crazy idea as sometimes it was called, into a political instrument. There is a quote by the first president of the ERC, by Fotis Kafatos, who spoke after the fact of the miracle of the ERC, and basically this part of the book is trying to look behind this claim of a miracle and try to find out what forces were in place and what dynamics were in place that made this crazy idea into a political instrument. So I have three periods. One is the ERC campaign, where people like Jerzy and others were basically taking up this idea of an ERC, an independent funding agency at European level, and tried to basically sell it to governments and to the European Commission. Then there is the period when the European Commission took this over and made this, connected the loose ends of this idea and made it into a kind of political strategy in order to bring it through the European institutions. And then 2006 to 2007, it was already decided principally that there should be an ERC, and then there was the period when the organizational questions were addressed. Part then deals with these organizational issues, the governance structure, and the basic problem here is how to moderate between the European Commission as the formal paternal organization and the scientific community and the ERC advocates who, rightly or not, claim that the ERC belongs to them. The fact here is that the ERC was built after the template of the National Science Foundation, the US funding agency that exists since 1950, but of course the EU institutional framework is very different than the US or any national framework. So the ERC is not really an organization, not really an entity in itself, but it is more, you know, a political instrument that is that rests on different legal entities, and that, on the other hand, then always raises the question again and again: whom does the ERC belong to? And in these two chapters, I basically look into the discussions in the early phase of the ERC, how Commission representatives and members of the scientific council try to address and solve these issues. Then finally, there is the section, two chapters on the operational issues of the ERC. The problem here, of course, is how to legitimize funding that goes to specifically academic research in a context that is clearly oriented towards innovation policy. The ERC hails itself that it selects projects based on scientific qualities only. But of course, the EU policies in general require a contribution to innovativeness, whatever that means. And so the ERC tried to solve this problem, or tried to solve this by revising the old narrative, inventing the frontier research metaphor instead of basic research, speaking of excellence very strongly, which became, of course, a very important notion in itself, and then also later embarking on the idea that funding academic research would at one point also foster radical innovation as something different than incremental innovation that is usually achieved through more traditional ways of funding for SMEs and, you know, thematic research and so on. So with that, I turn to the second part of this brief introduction. What is the significance of the book as far as I see it? The first one is that I tried that I want to shed light on the ERC as a unique instrument in the European context, and that I also want to discuss a little bit this insider-outsider position that I had when I first became part of the ERC team, and later then started to write the book on the ERC. So, on the success story, this is something that really goes very deep. I mean, even Manuel Barroso, who was not a big fan of funding research during his tenure as Commission President, then in his final comments after when he finished his term, said specifically mentioned the ERC and said the ERC is one of the great big successes of his tenure. Which just tells you that even though it is a very tiny instrument in the grand scheme of things, it is very highly regarded by politicians. But of course, success means different things to different people involved. And along the three sections that I presented before, success can mean that the fact that it has been established, the ERC has been established against all odds. It can also mean the fact that it has been functioning despite the organizational constraints that could have been witnessed, in particularly in the early days. And it also could mean the fact that it has been distributing vast amount of money in a way that only rather few see as problematic. So the legitimacy of the ERC doing funding is actually very high. For me, more important is that the ERC is unique in two ways. The ERC has an unseen degree of delegating decision-making powers under the umbrella of the European Commission to a separate body, which is the ERC Scientific Council. And it is also unique in the sense that it is funding academic research not by the way it is doing it, but that it is on the one hand very conventional in the way it does it, but in the contexts, if you look at it, it is again very unconventional. And let me just briefly explain what I mean by that. If you take the ERC as one of many funding agencies that are out there, like the DFG in Germany, or, you know, the Research Council in Great Britain, or the ENSF and others, then you see that they basically nowadays have similar programs. In Germany, for example, you have the Emmy Noether program, which addresses young researchers, postdocs, which gives them a lot of money in order to build up their team and then come up with research for the next 3 to 5 years. And the ERC, of course, does the same with the starting grant. But there is one difference between the national funding and the ERC, of course, and it is that the ERC plays into a transnational space. And by that I mean, if you have an Emmy Noether grant, you are certainly recognized by the rector of the University of Düsseldorf and by the University of Cologne, but the rector of the University of Lisbon will probably not really know what to do with it. If you have an ERC starting grant, you will immediately recognized in Lisbon, you're immediately recognized in Kent or in Oslo or in Düsseldorf or in Rome or in Krakow, for example. So this is really a symbolic surplus that the ERC creates that is unmatched by any national funding agency. The other unconventionality of the ERC is in the context of the EU research funding programs, simply because it is this focus on scientific qualities only, and the simple funding streams that have been set up, and the fact that the decision making is with scientists or lays with scientists and not with commission functionaries. So this is definitely the big difference that the ERC has in comparison to other framework programs. Finally, to my own position as a as someone who worked within the ERC for a while and then afterwards wrote a book on it, there is a certain ethnographic component to it, which is not really laid out in the book, but I mentioned this in presentations on the book because I find it a particularly striking example. If you ever have by chance been to the ERC headquarters or to the ERC executive agency headquarters and you step out of the elevator, you see this sign, this signpost with a very grandiose saying. It says the European Research Council Executive Agency is dedicated to selecting and funding the excellent ideas that have not happened yet and the scientists that are dreaming them up. And it's very, you know, a very grandiose and very bold what they want to do. But then if you look closer and you see the signpost, what it is made of, it is on a very cheaply woven material. And to me, it really symbolizes these two sides of the ERC. On the one hand, playing into this world-class research agenda. On the other hand, being a very cost-cutting mentality, executive agency of the European Commission. I never found out if this signpost was deliberately put on this cheap material, because of course there are also people from the Court of Auditors coming to the agency at one point, and maybe they wonder why they could afford a more expensive way of putting this saying, or whether it is just an unconscious reflection or unconscious representation of this cost-cutting mentality, but I find it very striking in any case. So that brings me to my role with the ERC. I was with the ERC for almost 4 years, between 2010 and 2013, when I was an advisor to the president of the ERC, Helga Novotny. And that meant basically three tasks. I was presenting the ERC to the outside world, or helped Helga presenting the ERC to the outside world. That means I was crafting the ERC narrative. Second, I was supporting her in bridging this organizational divide. You know, I had a lot of meetings where a lot of you try to resolve a lot of misunderstandings and so on internally. And of course, orchestrating the selection procedure, that is selecting the panel members, the panel chairs for the ERC panels, and so on and so on. And after the ERC, when I embarked on the journey of writing a book, the most intellectually demanding and interesting part of this work was actually what I would call, in relation to what in psychoanalysis you have this idea of Trauerarbeit, work of grievance. And for me it was kind of a work of distancing, getting out of this ERC narrative that was in my head very present, and getting a more objective or neutral perspective and more contextual perspective on the ERC, embedding the ERC in the context of what was going on in the 2000s in research policy and in European integration, the European integration project by and large, and also exploiting the insights that I have gained, of course, which was the great advantage to other scholars, that I had a lot of material from my work with the ERC, and exploiting these insights and connecting the dots in order to come up with a convincing narrative about the ERC history. So, to conclude, the ambition of my book was to write the definitive account of the ERC's history. until someone else comes and takes it up and writes the next definitive account. I also wanted to reach different audiences with the book, so I it was not supposed to be a book entirely only for scholars, but I also wanted to write it for policymakers, scientists, and ERC advocates. And that meant for me, when I was preparing this presentation and reflected about the writing process, basically that I had to write a book that was easily accessible and easy to read, but at the same time also academically credible. And the second part was, of course, also that I wanted to give a sympathetic history of the ERC, but still I wanted to clearly show that there is that I'm not just an ERC advocate myself, that I have a certain distance in the way I assess the ERC. And it would be interesting for me, among many other things, to hear from you whether this has worked or not. So that's my presentation.